Yeah, it's nice to hear from Dr. Sam Reddy Garu, who has given an introduction about the virus and its what are the different conditions, pandemic and all. Now, are you able to see the slides? Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, we are. Yes.
Yeah. So this is the plasma therapy, which is one of the recent lot of people are discussing about the at the level of WHO and also at the level of the FDA and also in India, also the ICMR has which can be made efforts on this to make plasma therapy. But the plasma therapy has given different multidimensional directions, because sometimes it is working well and sometimes it is not working well, because especially you can see that especially Ebola, it was not worked properly. So that's why I made a small effort that the plasma therapy a boon or bane to COVID-19 prevention, because sometimes the plasma therapy, it will be beneficial, and sometimes it may not be beneficial. That's why I put a nutshell how it can make useful for this plasma therapy. So just now, I think Dr. Sam Reddy explained that this is the phenotype and genotype of the virus. There are the spike glycoproteins and envelope membrane proteins. Especially, this is very important about hemagglutinin stress, HE. Some of the coronavirus had this HE, some didn't have. That is the, especially, alpha, beta, gamma, like that, some of these virus types are there. So the nucleoprotein is there, and also genome RNA is there. So this way, the virus is, I think recently, just now one of the participants asked about the mutants and all. Because the mutations, it is, which are sometimes you can see the knockout mutations, deletions are there, and sometimes you can see that the virus can different way they can behave differently depending on their what you can call as the pandemic situation. Especially it was earlier endemic, now it is sporadic, now it became a pandemic. So like that, the virus is going to change some of the variations in their phenotypic structure and also genotype structure. And now these are the functional properties of this, already discussed earlier, a nucleic acid protein and spike protein and envelope protein, membrane protein, especially the spike protein playing very, very important role, especially in the diagnostic part of you, and also some of the, what you can call as the receptor binding and what you can see the recognition of the cells and all. So the envelope protein, which is the fusion and membrane protein will be there. So these are the simple structure functionalities of the viral component and all. And this is according to the Baltimore strategy of the classification of genome replication and expression. So it can follow the strategy 4B strategy, because the virus is enveloped, it fuses with the cell and then replicate in the cellular host by especially receptor mediated endocyte process. And then there are different translation mechanisms are there like this. So there can be Golgi bodies, rough endoplasmic reticulum, like that it will come. And it will release outside of the host cell, and then it will go for binding the other cells. So I think Nature Reviews has given one of the important trinity of the COVID-19, especially the trinity that here you can see the immunity, inflammation, and interventions are there. So the immunity especially playing very important role in the host mechanism. And once the immunity, which can play important for the different type of the what you can call as host response, and also both the innate immunity, adaptive immunity, and also sometimes passive immunity also playing very important role depending on the type of the product which is released by this COVID-19 response against the especially cell. And inflammation is another important, and also another one is intervention. So these are three important which are a trinity which playing a very important role in the life cycle of the virus. Especially you can see in this here, once the virus entered and come out in the virion, which is infectious particles enter into the neighboring cells, there you can see the interleukins and also the positive feedback mechanism, interferons and macrophages, monocytes can be respond for this. And then later there is a leaky mechanism, vascular permeability, where you can see the macrophages and this dysfunction of the immune response occurs. And the health immune response will be there, people where you can cells so rapidly cleared, and also which can make the virus what you can call inactivated by neutralization antibodies and all. So here the virus specific antigens, where virus specific antibodies can be triggered, and also virus which can be now circulate in system, which can make the tropism, depending, you know, if the virus has a tropism is there, it can enter into this through nasal and also go to the alveoli and all, and then it can make a lot of response to the both immunity inflammation and also interventions are there. So a lot of people are talking about the cytokine storm, because this is one of the important immunological mechanism. So once the virus enter into the system of the lungs and all, so the chemokines and also the cytokines which can be triggered, and also the dendritic cells, a lot of the immunological mechanism which can be encountered, and especially the virus where it can play important role in the immune system, and immunity also play important role depending on the type of the host where you can see that. Now the COVID-19 pathogenic phases, I think just now that Sambar Edgar explained that there are different stages are there. Stage 1, which is early infection there, and stage 2, pulmonary phase, and stage 3, hyper inflammation phase is there. So where you can see the viral response phase will slowly it will go down, and then host inflammatory response will be increased when the it coming to hyper inflammation phase is there. So there is a lot of mild constitutional symptoms will be there, fever, shortness of the breath, and ARDS, especially shock, cardiac failure, some of the abnormalities, and the clinical stages also. In the stage 1, you can see the lymphopenia, increased the prothrombin, and also increased the dimer and LDH. And the second phase, you can see the abnormal chest transaminitis and low normal procalcitrants, and also elevated inflammatory markers are there in this. So like that, it is the pathogenic phases are which can be variable depending on the type of the early infection, pulmonary phase, and hyperinflammation phase, where you can see the severity of the illness will be depending on the the virus stage. That's why important. So in the here in the immune response also, so you can see the pneumonia, especially the lungs, and the neutrophil response, and the flow inflammatory cytokines existence, and also plasma cells and B cells and alveolar epithelial type 2 and other cells can be there. So these are the main viral host interactions which can be delayed or suppressed in the type 1, IF interference, and the viral replication triggers hyperinflammatory conditions, an influx of activated neutrophils and inflammatory monocytes and macrophages are there. So like that, there are different what you can call responses, immune response occur in the system. And depending on this system, the way you can see the alveolar can be, effectiveness will be there. So that is what. So this is the what you can call antibody responses to SARS-CoV in patients with COVID-19. So especially the antibodies like the IgG, especially the primarily IgM and IgG will there, and also you can see IgG and IgM. So both you can see that there is a response of the antibodies. So in the positive rate and also day after symptoms of onset, you can see 14 to 16 days. So the IgG will be increasing, and also the IgM is declining, and there is the IgG and IgM sloping will be different. This is recently the Nature has given explanation about this happening and all. And then another one is the zero conversion time of the antibodies against SARS. Here, this is very important in this immunological mechanism, especially the zero conversion, IgG, IgM zero conversions are there, and also synchronous zero conversions. Especially you can see the patients of different age group, especially male and female groups, and days we can see the IgG, IgM synchronous zero conversions starts from the 10th day, it going up 15th and going 20 like that. So because the male and female, you can see variability is there in there. Now what you can call as the synchronous so one of the important discussions earlier happened, why this males and female variation in their zero conversions as depending on their immunological system and sexual variation and blood group. Also some people are discussing about the one of the important factors for that to COVID interaction in the system. So IgM zero conversion, earlier IgG, where you can see that So the log phase you can see in the patients, and IgG, IgM seroconversion earlier than IgG, and IgG seroconverted earlier than IgME in some of the patients is happening. So by depending on this, now what you can call conversion of these antibodies. So then coming to the picture, actually the plus now everybody is talking about the CP therapy. CP, now some of the people says the CPT, convalescent plasma therapy. So the convalescent plasma therapy is one of these, is actually this is one of the oldest methods, but recently the people, because this COVID-19, which because they didn't have any vaccines and chemotherapy was not properly designed, some of the only what chemotherapy available now only, they can interfere with the viral replication, the halting of the replication. That's why that you can't completely suppression. That's why the temporary relief, not that much, no complete elimination of the virus. So this is a classic adaptive immunotherapy, which can be a prevention and a treatment of many infectious diseases for more than one century. But CP therapy was successful, used in the treatment of SARS, MERS, and H1N1 pandemic. But it was failed in the Ebola because the reasons of what you can get development of the neutralizing antibodies not properly. That's why Ebola case, the convalescent plasma therapy was not successful. And then patients who have recovered from the COVID-19 with a high neutralizing antibody titer may be valuable, because this is one of the important key factor in this CP therapy, convalescent plasma therapy. So this is the reason the patients who are recovered from the COVID-19, the titer will be very, very low. That's why sometimes it was not successful. And also very important is the stage of the collection of this one is very, very important. When you have to collect the, neutralize the plasma from that is very crucial. I will come later about that. So this is a simple layman view of this convalescent therapy. So where you can see that people who are COVID-19, which can recovered from this and blood plasma, you can draw it. And then virus neutralizing antibodies can be obtained, and then different methods are there for isolating and then quantifying and analysis, and then this can be injected into the, or you can call as transfuse into the COVID-19 patients where they can recover like that. So like that here, the convalescent now, they recovered the COVID-19 plasma can be used for different. Here's recently, I think the monoclonal antibodies also, now people are trying to make how the through genetic engineering and all, but that also one of the successful, but it takes a little bit more time for that. This is a layman picture of this. Now, these are the very important essential elements which will play a pivotal role in the convalescent plasma program. So donors who are recovered from the COVID-19 disease and meet eligibility criteria to donate convalescent serum. That is very important. Eligibility is one of the important. And especially here, we can make a special attention, which I will assure the plasma donation will be safe for the recovering patients and donor. This is very important. Safe, you can put underline. Safe is one of the important what you can call factors which are involved in this. Approach to screen recovered COVID patient to identify potential donors. This is also very important. Potential donors. So, and eligible donors and potential donors. Recovery will need to demonstrate with appropriate standardized viral nucleic acid and antibody screening, which is important because severe cases have tested positive for SARS-CoV at or beyond day 10 post-onset. So these the tests are very crucial. Now a lot of tests are now involved. Now the people are going to racing up these viral diagnostics, both the what you can call point-to-point diagnostics and also the immunological diagnostics and the nucleic acid diagnostics. But those should be very crucial, because when they're collecting this plasma, that the stage of the patient, when they recovered, that is before the window period, what are the tests you can do, after window period you have to do. These are very important, playing important role for that. Those tests are very important to know the what is the viral load and what is this immunoglobulin load, should be very quickly how to do it. And recently, approved serological assays are, lot of methods are in the platform. Perform especially antibody titers in eligible donors. Understanding of type of antibody being measured. This is also very important. Understanding type, what type, IgG is there, IgM is there. So that is also you have to take. And also this is very important, selection of desired antibody levels. So because some of these, people say FDA says that more than 1 in 320 titers should be there, recommended titers. Sometimes some are WHO sometimes say so more than 160 titer will be there. But the safe side, the FDA has recommended 1:320 titer. So identify blood banking facilities. This is where the plasma patients, especially the plasmapheresis, is one of the important experience where we can see that. And select the specific products to be prepared, especially fresh plasma, lyophilized plasma, because sometimes you have to preserve the plasma. You have to sometimes they collect a lot of plasma and make it preserved for the available. But because the patients are coming more, the plasma which can donors or which are volunteers are coming less. That's why, and also the specific plasma should be very good, high titer and all. This is very important for them. And establish a dosage schedule based on knowledge of SARS-CoV-2 antibody. This is also very important. How much dosage schedule you have to make it also very important. Establishment of a registry of possible future donation to cancer. So this way, now I think in India, we are in the first wave, probably. So it is going to be in the logarithmic phase. We don't know when it's coming to slow, because that's why you have to be very careful about this collection of the plasma. So donors for convalescent plasma transfusion, the recovery criteria is very, very crucial in this. Normality of the body temperature for more than 3 days, resolution of respiratory tract symptoms, 2 consecutively negative results of sputum, SARS-CoV-2, RT-PCR, a 1-day sampling interval. Collection of the donors, blood after 3 week post and set of illness and 4 days of post discharge. So these criteria, which can play very important role when the convalescent plasma we are collecting for the transfusion. And who can donate? Because here 2 important factors are there. One is the donor, another one is the recipient. Who has to, from whom we have to collect the plasma, for whom we are going to transfuse. So donor should be between 18 to 55 years of age and weight at least minimum 55. Have a prior verified diagnosis of COVID-19, but are now symptom-free and fully recovered from COVID-19. Donors not fit to donate blood based on the history and examination will be deferred and excluded from the plasma donor pool. So this is the donor who are not fit for donation, because with history you can take it. So the historical importance of the person, because people are immediately detected out going for some of the things, like suppose the donor who has the some earlier, the autoimmune diseases are there, immunodeficient diseases are there, some of the contagious diseases which are there in the body. So what happens when you collect? So when you can, without doing proper study diagnostics, we can collect plasma, that there are chances for making the contamination. I think that I'll talk to you in the after some time. So exclusion criteria, especially pregnant women, breastfeeding women, known hypersensitivity blood components, receipt of poor immunoglobulin in the last 30 days, and the critical ill patients. And also you can see some of the important videos. Then what type of testing, what you have to do, the convalescent plasma, serological test and real-time PCR detection of SARS-CoV and other pathogenics which can be tested, which are going to collect the convalescent plasma. Determination of neutralizing activity of plasma by plaque reduction, neutralization test using SARS-CoV-2 virus. And how you can define the neutralizing titer as the highest serum dilution, with 50% reduction in the number of plaques as compared with the number of plaques in wells in the absence of non-coronavirus antibody as a blank control. So then detection of neutralizing activity of the receptor binding domain of antibody in the CP by a sandwich enzyme ELISA, that is what we can do. SARS-CoV-2 IgG antibody titer tested by ELISA. And detection of SARS-CoV-2 RNA by RT-PCR assay and the result present as cycle threshold. This is very important. Cycle threshold value should be very critical here. And then finally, in the testing, the serology screening of hepatitis B, C, and HIV, syphilis, and sometimes spirochetes also should be there. So you have to negative all for all these one in the same. So a serological test you can do, or immunological, or marker-based diagnostic you can do for detection of the what you can call infectious agents. So the potential mechanism of the coronavirus antibody neutralization and antibody enhancement of infection. So when the spike protein comes and then receptor binding is there and internalization is there into endocytosis and membrane fusion is there and ions can be released from the one. So here antibody binding spikes, protein and FCR. So you can see the FCR which can bind the antibodies, especially the antibodies with the antigen, and then what internalization occurs, which can be through what you can call as endocytosis mechanism and membrane fusion and release the viral genetic material, then this will be make the enhancement for neutralization and antibody, production and all respond for this, especially the plasma cells and beta cells, the B cells. And this is the passive antibody therapy. Basically, the plasma therapy is a passive antibody, and the passive immunization with convalescent plasma involves transfusion of the cellular portion of blood from individuals who have recovered from an infection to a person who infected or at risk of infection. So the plasma donors are especially presumed to have developed the effective antibody response to the offering pathogen. The conferred immunity is shorter. So, and also you can transfuse of convalescent plasma with high neutralizing antibody titer dose addition per recipient body weight. This is also very important. It is required for therapeutic effectiveness. A retrospective analysis defined the importance of providing the plasma within 8 days of the onset of illness. This is what you can see there. So now the next generation passive immunization also coming, that is calling as convalescent plasma, has several limitations, including batch to batch variability and requirement for blood type matching. And also a sample must also be screened for blood-borne pathogens, including hepatitis HIV. And monoclonal antibodies administration, an alternative to convalescent plasma. This is also one of the important, the next generation passive immunization, which can make use of the control of the viral, what you can call the infection. Multiple techniques now allow the rapid recovery of antiviral monoclonal antibodies or antibody derivatives. In vitro selection approaches with yeast or phage display, and especially the phage display, one of the important, and animal immunization with the subsequent antibody, human, especially immunization, and antigen-specific single B cell sorting or epistemic-wise B cell immortalization. These are what you can do. Two approaches are involved. One is blood sample obtained from recovered individuals. And second approach is monoclonal antibodies can also be rapidly scaled up for testing during outbreaks. This is also one of the important. So there are notable examples are there in the what you can call MBA monoclonal antibodies, 114, which is a single antibody, and also a 3RD. Now I think in the next generation, 3-antibody cocktail also we can make use of this, what you can call as passive immunization of this. And these are the different trials of the convalescent plasma, especially the randomized control trial. Especially you can see patients who have received 2 units of CP and survival without need of ventilation or immunomodulating drugs. And then, you know, placebo control trials are there, COVID-19 patient, where you can see number of ventilators, 3 days and all. Like that, the different trials are made on convalescent plasma, especially randomized control trials, and also time to clinical recovery after randomization. And then overall mortality and clinical improvement, 2 points or more than 7 point scale, and percentage of the patients requiring ventilation, high flow oxygen or extra, what you can call as the corporeal membrane oxygenation, like that. So several trials which are made for the convalescent plasma, starting from the what you can call as survival to the final, you can see the minimum 2 point improvement to 6 point clinical scale, especially in the randomized double blind parallel control trial of CP patients with the severe coronavirus pneumonia. So these are the trials which are made for convalescent plasma. And these trials are now, a lot of modifications are changing, or some of the changes occurring in this depending on the trial methodology, and also some of the what you can call SOPs, and some of the things that are coming up. So the convalescent plasma component and its mechanism of action. So see, this is the what you can see, the convalescent plasma, which can be what you can collect from the patient, and then you can process it, and which contains the anti-inflammatory cytokines, other factor, albumin, all. And then neutralization antibody can be antiviral, where you can see spike glycoproteins, where IgG sarcoid, IgM also there. And immunomodulator effects is there, pro-inflammatory cytokines, complement C3A, C5A, and autoantibodies, and HLA2, and CD80 and CD86, IL-12, IL-10, which can be enhancing. And also neutralization of the cytokines, complement and auto antibodies, like what you can, IL-6, IL-4 enhancement, IL-5, and then like that, what you can see there. So these convalescent plasma components and mechanism action is very, very important. These immunomodulator effects are very, very crucial when you are studying about the plasma therapy of this insulin, right? And especially who are the patients are eligible for this? Once the donor, and you can collect the plasma from the donor, and then you can, who are the eligible for patients? We are going to use the convalescent plasma, CPT, convalescent plasma therapy for that patients. So especially the laboratory confirmed patients and severe or immediately life-threatening COVID-19, severe disease is identified as one of more of the following: shortness of breath, especially dyspnea, and respiratory frequency, and blood oxygen saturation, and partial pressure of the arterial oxygen to fraction of inspired oxygen ratio less than 300, lung infiltration more than 50% within 20 to 48 hours, and life-threatening disease defined as one of the more following: respiratory failure, septic shock, and multiple organ section of the or failure. These are the, you have to consider where in the you are doing the eligibility of the patients. And finally, you have to inform the consent provided to the patient or healthcare proxy of that, right? So this is the clinical data, which is where the for COVID data supporting use of convalescent plasma are limited because small, which are cohorts, now the people are working on plasma therapy and they either in the worldwide, they are taking a small cohorts, small sample, 14, 15 samples, and case by case they're studying and all. So, and also there are sometimes what happened they are doing, but the clinical data sometimes missing because the immunoglobulin levels, hyperimmunoglobulin levels, which are no data is missing. So that's why sometimes they are performing the plasma therapy, but there is no proper data, clinical data. And also the convalescent plasma is evaluated other viral disease also. Not only this SARS, some of the other also they are using for this. That's why they are, now already I told this MERS, SARS and also the other disease also they did, but except the Ebola, which was failed. So like that, there are clinical data, which is specific immunoglobulin, especially hyperimmunoglobulin, like that. We can use the clinical data is very important for this. And several virus-specific immunoglobulin conducts licensed for preventing post-transplant cytomegalo diseases and post-exposed prophylaxis of varicella, now zoster and all. These are the some of the clinical data which is need more for the plasma therapy because there is a lacking. A lot of people are now working and doing, but only certain data is coming out with the proper, what you can call database, and also FDA approval and also WHO approval. Sometimes the data is not proper, incomplete. That's why it's unable to make access for these people who are going to do other trials. So then clinical trials and access, randomized clinical trials to evaluate convalescent plasma for the treatment, especially which is COVID-19 underway, because there are a list of available clinical trials are making, and these trials are evaluating for the immunoglobulin levels. And also the convalescent plasma emergency investigation, new drug application also, they're making out this. And FDA also, they are expanding the access program for this convalescent plasma recently. And they are encouraging more people to do that because now this is a pandemic situation. That's why people are thinking to make more efforts on that. But when you're going to clinical trials, there is some of the adverse effects also there. This is one of the adverse effect, which is my negative point of some of the things. And the risk associated with the plasma transfusion, including antibody mediated enhancement of infection, transfusion-associated acute lung injury, and transfusion-associated circulatory overload, and allergic transfusion reactions. These are the adverse effect will be there when you're doing this clinical trials. So you should be very careful when you're doing this, these adverse effects, which can be overruled, and also we have to make alternative mechanism on this. So rare complication, including transmission of infectious pathogens and red cell, so aluminization. So these should be take care from this, when you are doing this, and also the consideration on the pregnancy especially, and also consideration of children. And another one, hyperimmunoglobulin has been used to treat several viral infections in children, including varicella zoster, respiratory syncytial, CMV, and efficacy data for other respiratory viruses is limited. So the efficacy and adverse effect associated with administration of convalescent plasma and have been well established. This is very important that non-SARS-CoV specific intravenous immunoglobulin also you can see the effect on this. And recommendations that the COVID-19 treatment guidelines recommended against the use of non-SARS-CoV-2 specific intravenous immune globulins for treatment of COVID-19, except in the context of some of the clinical trials. This should not preclude the use of what you can call as intravenous immune globulin, and when it is otherwise indicated for the treatment of complications that arise during the course of the COVID-19. And there are different challenges are there. Challenges are coming now because once the plasma therapy is going on, different challenges come. Some of the studies which indicate reduce the serum and response with uncertain implementing time. And CP infusion still has its latent risk, such as aggravating hyperimmune attacks based on the foundation of the CP therapy, the passivity, the administration pathogen-specific antibodies to patients. and also the more effective in the earlier stage of disease. SARS have confirmed the optimal timings of administration CP. This is very important, optimal timing of administration of the convalescent plasma in the COVID. Very, very carefully you have to do this, because depending on this, you can get the results of the, what you can call as the recovery of the patient, because this administration and also dose, the titer of the, you know, the plasma and also the time is very crucial in this. The therapeutic effect of CP and especially determine the by level of SARS-CoV-2 neutralizing antibody titer. So the NAT is, the titer is also you have to check, and the titer is good, then it will be successful. Otherwise, titer is not that much low. That's why now we are struggling this. People are collecting the plasma from, I think here also Tirupati in the SWIMS, the ICMR has given the direction. They're collecting the sample from the different people, and then the titer of the, you know, the what you can call as plasma titer is very less. When you are going to, you know, then transfuse, the titer is not that much level. That's why the people are unable to recover properly. Still, they are, you know, the disease going on. Sometimes this is very important when the level of neutralizing antibodies also you have to check. So it is on SARS demonstrates that the specific IgG began to increase around third week of onset and peaked with the 12th week. So the most common adverse reaction CP therapy are transfusion related events involving chills, fever, so anaphylactic reactions, transfusion related lung injuries, circulatory overload and hemolysis. Another risk, already I told you, the in the transmission, in, especially in the transfusion, the virus which are hidden viruses which are there, which are not properly diagnosed, which are known because history was not properly known. Sometimes at the time of window period you collected, it's very difficult to detect the pathogens or challenges to make this plasma therapy. And this is one of the main what you can call as the risk in the plasma therapy. That's why the history of the patient is very important in this. Finally, just I am going to conclude, because the CP therapy is a potential treatment for COVID-19, but some of the challenges to be dealt with. So these are the challenges which has to encountered, and then you have to do it. And the plasma therapy can be considered in the absence of specific treatment, and it can be alternate option in emergent situation of COVID-19. So with this one, I think this is the nutshell what I have given the plasma therapy, because a lot of people are working and the outcome is very less. Some people are disappointed. Some people are making more efforts, still are there, but still it is in the incubation stage. I think sometimes it is not that much fulfilled. So that's why if you can use this plasma therapy like a double-edged knife, so you can use beneficial way, or you can use with sometimes properly not use this, it will be what you can call as the, it will negative way. So with this small presentation, thank you for the Vignan University has given me opportunity, Mr. Kar. Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. And before we move on to the next speaker, so we have two questions.
Yeah, please.
So why can't we do stem cell therapy for boosting our immunity?
Yeah, stem cell therapy, we can, but stem cell therapy, which is important, okay, you can do it. But only thing is the specific seed should be there, because this is, we are using the antiviral, right? So going to COVID encountering, so you can use it stem cell, but the stem cell which is specific for what you can call as the, for the against the virus, and then which can be enhance the antibodies and all, we can use that, right? Now people are using the plasma. Suppose you can do the, you know, plasma therapy, the cells which are generating the, what you can call as the, no, B cell, what you're going to call it as in the new cells, we can use it, generate one, then you can use it also. But that is right. Okay, that's a good question.